All right, I think it's been enough time here. Going to get started. I'd like to welcome everyone to the second of the International Water Resources Association webinars for World Water Day. This year's theme, 2021, is Valuing Water. I don't know if anyone here watching today is came this morning. I know Dr. Jewett also watched this morning, so special points to him. But if anyone else has seen both, maybe you can do a little comparison for us. Tell us what you enjoy more. Our panelists for this afternoon include Dr. Anita Millman, Associate Professor at the Department of Environmental Conservation at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, PhD candidate Normandi Erding, Asia Pacific Regional Ambassador for the Water Science Policy, Saif Aquayun, Bangladesh Country Coordinator for the 2030 Water Resources Group with the World Bank, and Dr. Graham Jewett, Honorary Professor at the Center of Water Resources Research at the University of KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa. So we have a really great panel. We're really excited about this. And as just to remind everybody, this is a webinar hosted by the International Water Resources Association. And the IWRA is an international network of researchers and practitioners who work on a multidisciplinary range of water resource issues. We are a nonprofit, non-governmental educational organization. And the IWRA provides a global knowledge-based forum for bridging disciplines and geographies by connecting professionals, students, individuals, corporations, and institutions, everyone who's concerned with the sustainable use of the world's water resources. So we're really happy to have everyone here today. So thank you for tuning in. We have such a great panel. And like I say, we have both practitioners and researchers and people who have a lot of experience in the field and people who are just getting started in the field, kind of the rising stars, you might say. So I think we bring in a lot of different perspectives here together. So, as you know, our panel will speak about World Water Day, celebrated every year on March 22nd, and it's a day that brings attention to our water resources. I think it's a day for every one of us who works kind of in the water field. It's sort of a somewhat of a holiday, but some of a time to help raise awareness for our field for what we find important. So, the theme of World Water Day for 2021 is Valuing Water, and I think what's really interesting about this is, to me, one of my favorite topics that we've used for World Water Day in the last few years is that, you know, it goes beyond the issues of just pricing, which has been something that's discussed so often, but it can also ties into questions about how we look at the issues of environmental or social and cultural values that people put on water. You know, with water coming under increased stress due to climate change, due to population growth, due to pollution, being able to kind of understand the many different competing ways that people value the resource becomes a real key way to find out how we can equitably balance against competing demands into the future. So I think a lot of you probably have already been to our webinars before, but I'll just briefly explain the format of today's webinar. So to start, each of our panelists will have a short 10-minute presentation-ish, and then at the end, we're going to have time for questions from the audience. So you can see at the bottom of your box, your Zoom screen, there's a Q&A section. I already had a question. And wow, that's quite quick. So go ahead and type in your questions at the bottom, and we'll get those answered as we can at the end of the event. And we'll get as many of them done as possible. But if you have a question that, you know, you'd like to ask a single panelist about a point on their slides or anything, go ahead and look them up online and send them a quick email to their work email address. And I'm sure they'll respond. They're all very friendly people. And I'm sure they'd be happy to follow up with you. And, you know, of course, like I say, posing of your questions in our chat box, and we'll get to those. If we can't get to all your questions, we'll do our best. Now, just to remind everybody, we will have a copy of the recording of the webinar, as well as the PDFs, the presentations, both for this webinar and the webinar that we had this morning, all on our website, www.iwra.org. You just give us a few days, we'll get those up there. So, with that in mind, I'm going to turn the floor over to our first speaker and our moderator, Dr. Anita Millman, Associate Professor at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. So, and I believe you are the chair of the IWRA Groundwater Task Force? Yes, chair of our IWRA Groundwater Task Force. So, okay, the floor is yours.
Great. Good morning, afternoon, and evening, everyone. As Scott just introduced me, I am a professor in the Department of Environmental Conservation at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. And I'd like to begin first by thanking all of you for joining the IWRA to celebrate World Water Day. Now, because it is World Water Day, and because all of you have voluntarily taken the time to join this webinar today, I'm gonna begin by admitting that I talk about water a lot. I wouldn't say that I talk about water more often than not, but I definitely talk about water with decided frequency. And in all of the discussions I've had over the years, I've lost track of the number of times when during a conversation, someone will say to me, "Anita, the problem is we do not value water enough." Now, when we say somebody says this, they mean to apply one of three things. Either the people use water wastefully, the people are unwilling to pay for more for water, or that because people can access water for free or it's undercharged on the market, people do not recognize the true cost of their water use. Now, valuing water is not a panacea. Politics, power dynamics, institutional factors. I'm a political scientist. I think all of these things have a large influence over the way in which we manage our water. But the overall tendency not to attribute the full value to water does mean that as humans, we frequently choose to manage water in ways that do not fully take into consideration our actions. So the theme of this year's World Water Day, Valuing Water, is specifically aimed at this flaw with the objective of raising awareness of the full value of water. We've made substantial progress in this, particularly in the aftermath of the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, which raised awareness of the ecosystem services and led way to valuing them. And since then, we've really learned to think about water, not just in terms of its economic contributions, but its broader contributions to society and to the integrity of our natural environment. But today, much of the emphasis has been on surface waters. And my goal today, as the coordinator for the newly formed IWRA Groundwater Task Force, is to draw attention to the unique contributions of groundwater and to shamelessly take this opportunity to draw your attention to the IWRA Task Force and to try to recruit your participation in them. So that aside, on topic, to be clear, the value of groundwater stems, much of the value of groundwater stems from benefits that it provides that are not very dissimilar to those provided by surface water. Most of these are what we would call provisioning benefits. Groundwater provides drinking water to on the order of 40 to 50% of the global population. It also accounts for about 43-50% of the water used for irrigation, and it's essential for supporting ecosystem services. So in these instances, the value of water can be characterized in terms of public health, food security, livelihoods, the economy, and the environment. And these contributions of groundwater, these are the ones that are most frequently recognized, both in instances when people sought to place a monetary value on groundwater, as well as when they talk about the benefits that it provides. But groundwater, as I said, makes a number of contributions that are distinct from surface water. And here's where I want to draw your attention. So first, and perhaps the most well-recognized but unique benefit of groundwater is its role in risk management. Groundwater flows, but it flows at much slower rates than surface water, which means that it serves as an important role in storage. We often turn to groundwater when due to either intra or inter-annual variations, surface waters are unavailable. So sometimes we use groundwater to manage risk quite simply by shifting from surface water diversion to pumping during drought. And in other times, we more actively manage risk through groundwater recharge and storage. So here on the slide, I've put up two projects by the Albuquerque Bernalillo County Water Utility Authority in New Mexico, where they've been actively using groundwater to manage hydroclimatic risk for a number of years. The project on the left is the Bear Canyon Recharge Project, where they divert surface waters through an unlined arroyo, and that water infiltrates into the aquifer. And on the right, there's the large-scale recharge project, where they inject treated surface water through injection wells into the aquifer. And then they store this water in the aquifer and then they withdraw it for use, particularly during summer months where it's peak demands and during drought. So while the use of groundwater to manage hydroclimatic risk is well recognized is the use of groundwater to manage political, social, and economic risk. Groundwater can be accessed quite broadly, anywhere geology is favorable and someone has the resources or the capacity to drill a well. This is, of course, why it's considered a commons. And in many locations, this aspect of groundwater is what makes it a valuable way to secure access and control over water. So we see this in the almost explosive expansion of private wells around the world. Groundwater private wells are taking off in many areas of the world where there's been insufficient public service or failures of public service to provide water to the population. So pictured here is some information from Lagos, Nigeria, where more than 55% of the population relies on private boreholes. The growth in private boreholes is not just happening in Nigeria, but it's happening and it's common in many, many other countries around the world. And even here in Massachusetts, where I live, where we have fairly well-functioning public infrastructure and a large quantity of water, a number of landowners are drilling their own private wells because those wells are unregulated. And so during drought, when water restrictions prevent them from using the piped water system for irrigation or gardens, they can rely on their wells to irrigate their outside landscapes. We also see risk management in terms of the use of groundwater for risk management in terms of the number of unregistered wells and the challenges of licensing and permitting wells around the world, as people are seeking to keep their water use hidden or away from the control of the public or the political eye. So in addition to the value that groundwater plays in risk management, the benefit that's derived from groundwater is that it can serve as a time machine. Water recharged to the aquifer flows down gradient and eventually discharges. And the rate of this flow, of course, depends on the soil properties and the transmissivity. But in areas where that transmissivity is favorable, not too fast, not too slow, people are taking advantage of this phenomena to retime flows of surface waters. So here I've pictured an example of this. This is the Hayborn Ponds Recharge Project, which is located in the South Platte River Basin in Colorado. What they are doing is they pump water out of the river during high flow seasons when there's free flow in the river, and they put it up in recharge ponds several miles away from the river. They then provide, those ponds provide wetland habitat for migrating birds, and slowly the water then filtrates back through the aquifer and returns to the river during the summer months when flows in the river at the lowest. This flow is then either available for appropriation for surface water diversions through out-of-priority pumping and or for protection of in-stream flows required for endangered species that are located downstream. So another valuable contribution of groundwater is it serves as a physical support, a foundation, so to speak. So groundwater fills the pore space in soil, and when groundwater depletion occurs, some soils will compact, leading to subsidence. So here I've pictured some subsidence that's occurring in Central Valley of California. In places, it's occurring at a rate of 10 to 17 centimeters per year due to overpumping of the groundwater aquifer, and that's creating massive damage, not just to roads, railroads, and bridges, but also to pipelines and canals that provide surface waters to those in the area. So groundwater doesn't only support the soil, it also supports itself. So a key factor influencing our abilities to use groundwater is the depth below the surface to the water level. And so even where an aquifer is quite deep, and there's plenty of water in storage, if the water levels drop below the screened area of a well, the water in storage is unavailable. So to give you an example of this, I've pictured the Cahuilla Groundwater Subbasin in California. They've recently completed a quite extensive study of their groundwater basin, and they've determined that they have an estimated total volume in storage of between 15 and 30 million acre feet of water. So a large quantity of water that is available in the aquifer. However, their groundwater modeling also showed that pumping only a small percentage of that water in storage was going to lead to dewatering of shallow wells, which would have very negative impacts, particularly on rural landowners and water users, as well as some of the municipal providers. So here the value of the groundwater in storage is really equivalent to that of a booster chair or a step stool, making it possible for others to access that water. Lastly, groundwater has value in that it can serve as a barrier. Through recharge or through pumping, the pressure gradient with groundwater systems can be manipulated to control how contaminants move within the aquifer. So we can change the way these gradients are moving in order to block or prevent diffusion of pollution throughout the system. So for example, here I've pictured the Orange County Water District in Southern California. They are perhaps one of the areas that's been most engaged in seawater intrusion prevention, perhaps for, I think at least since the 1960s, perhaps the 1970s, so for a long time. So they've got a number of wells where they inject water about 4 miles from the coast. They're putting in place imported water, so surface water, and highly treated wastewater. And they're injecting it into the aquifer in order to prevent seawater intrusion into the Talbot Aquifer, which is a shallow aquifer where they draw a lot of their water from. So in sum, groundwater provides a multitude of benefits, and many of these benefits constitute regulating or supporting benefits, meaning they are underlying processes that make possible the direct provisioning and cultural benefits that we derive from water, those more visible benefits that we derive for water. So if we don't have a way of observing, measuring, and paying attention to these regulating and supporting benefits, we're not going to recognize the true values that groundwater provides. And they're very extremely important. So if we're to manage all water as effectively possible, then we need greater attention to these unseen essential contributions of what is in reality an invaluable resource. So perhaps this is why for 2022, for World Water Day, the UN has aptly selected the theme of groundwater, making the visible invisible, the invisible visible. And why over the course of the next 3 years from us, you'll be hearing from the IWRA Groundwater Task Force a lot more about why groundwater rocks. So it does. Don't forget it. Thank you. So in the meantime, between now and 2022, we have many things to talk about besides groundwater. And what I'd like to do is transition us through some three fabulous presentations that are going to focus more on the value of water. And so I'd like to pass the microphone next to Nomandari Irden, who will talk to us about valuing water in the Guri areas of Mongolia. And she's going to highlight the utmost importance of access to water.
Thank you very much. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yes, very good.
Okay.
That looks good.
Great. Thank you very much for the introduction, and I thank International Water Resource Association for the opportunity. As Anita mentioned before, I want to contribute to the understanding of value of water by presenting water value issues of Gare area of Ulaanbaatar, which I believe is one of the most underreported regions of the world. My name is Nomandari Ertene, and I'm hydraulics engineer, and I also volunteer for water science policy as Asia Pacific regional ambassador. Ulaanbaatar is the capital city of Mongolia, which is a landlocked country in East Asia that borders with Russia and China. Mongolia is the 17th largest state in the world and is among those with the lowest population density with 3.2 million residents. And although Cyrillic writing is the official script, the traditional Mongolian scripts are taught in every school and it is largely involved in our everyday life. I prepared a short video. The capital and economic center of Mongolia is home to 1.6 million people. Ulaanbaatar's well fields supply around 200,000 cubic meters of water per day. However, the wastewater collected at the wastewater treatment plant amounts only to around 160,000 cubic meters per day. And one of the reasons for such a gap is that a large proportion of water is transported from the well fields to the water kiosks supplying the Gare area residents. Marked in white in this map, Gare areas are home to 60% of the whole population of Ulaanbaatar and comprise around 200,000 households. A Gare is a traditional circle dwelling, ideally suited for a nomadic pastoral lifestyle. The communities who live in Gares are referred to as Gare area residents, and it is considered to be peri-urban due to their detachment from the basic infrastructure services. And less than 1% of Gare area population is connected to piped water supplies. The rest supplied by 650 kiosks. This essentially means that one kiosk serves as a water resource for around 308 households, which is not enough. The video shortly describes the typical route for water transport to feed kiosks. Okay. So the Gare area consumers pay $0.54 per cubic meter of water, which is almost 80% higher than the tariff paid by the consumers living in other urban areas. Yet their water consumption on average is about 8 to 10 liters per capita per day. In stark contrast, apartment resident consumption reached up to 200 liters per capita per day, which is among the highest in the world. The average travel time to fetch water is high as 30 minutes. And expressed as a lost opportunity over working hours and average wage, it is estimated that around $400 is wasted every year to collect water. And children often the ones responsible for water collection. This not only has a negative impact on their education, but also exposes them to violent crimes and increases their vulnerability to health risks. And as far as sanitation is concerned, there's a lack of national standards for the construction of pit latrines facilities. And most of the times, these are very unsuitable and insensitive in terms of gender, life cycle, and privacy requirements. And despite it is recommended to withdraw the wastewater from the latrines, only a few households do so, given the cost attached to the service. As a consequence, gray wastewater is disposed into streets of gray areas, posing a higher risk of soil pollution and spread of water-related diseases. As a response mechanism to the burdens related to water access, private wells are constructed for self-consumption and water sales. And although private wells are integral component of the urbanization of the Ulaanbaatar, the exact number of private wells and the impact on water tariff sustainability, as well as the overall groundwater capacity, are not documented in any official reports yet. The conditions by which Gari area residents access water raised concerns about the implementation of the basic human rights to water and sanitation. However, a number of studies have concluded that the Gari area water consumers are satisfied with their water consumption, considering it adequate to their needs. This only shows the lack of knowledge of the benefits of safer and more convenient water access and sanitation. The majority fails to acknowledge and understand that the burdens and disadvantages of water access are only limited to the tariffs they pay for 1 liter of water. The socioeconomic consequences and health threats related to inadequate access to basic services are less visible, but equally detrimental in the long run. The city's water issues are rooted in its governance system. The 1990 Democratic Revolution resulted in the ratification of the first constitution, which has introduced decentralized decision-making. However, the organizational system was established without proper management and long-term plan. UNDP describes the Mongolian water sector as one of the most disorganized to be found. There's a number of state programs that aim to develop and improve the Gari area water access and sanitation conditions. For example, introduction of smart kiosks. Some of the pipe-fed water kiosks are smart. They are equipped with water security cameras, flow meters, and a touch screen for the payment transaction. They operate 24/7 and have substantially reduced the percentage of non-revenue water and water collection time. Smart kiosks contribute to the overall convenience for water consumers. However, they do not tackle the main challenges related to access inequality. The technology does not reduce the water prices, nor address the water-related risks or the overall burden of water collection by children. Apart from the state initiatives, there are many international projects that are implemented, one of which is the Millennium Challenge Corporation's bulk water supply expansion project, where I am employed as a project manager for the program management consultant team. So the bulk water supply expansion project aims to meet the water demands of the project, the population growth of Ulaanbaatar, by implementing three major activities. First is the construction of the advanced water purification plant. Second is the construction of wastewater recycling plant. And third is the water sector sustainability activity, which would be closely related to the development of Gari areas. Currently, most of the Gari area development programs rely on the construction of large-scale apartments with centralized connections. This is an incentive to reduce the phenomenon of Gari areas. However, the Gari are our tradition and identity. Sustainable water management should be based on a context-tailored, inclusive, and participatory approach, which means acknowledging the values, principles, and the vulnerabilities of the communities. And it is the member of the communities upon which the growth and development shall be built upon, whose values shall be carried on to the next generation. Last but not least, water is essential for survival and is a pivotal condition for the full achievement of human rights and dignity. Access to water should not be a burden or reason for suffering. As such, its socioeconomic and cultural values should be fully accounted for, recognized, and celebrated every day. I thank again International Water Resource Association, Water Science Policy, Tetra Tech, and Young Water Professionals Mongolia for the support. So that's it from my side for today, and I'm happy for the further discussion.
Great, terrific, thank you. That was a very interesting presentation that helps to raise awareness of the misvalue of water by those lacking access, the differences in value by differing actors within the system, and the way that water can be used as a tool for good or for bad in differing ways for change throughout society. So next we're going to move on to examining valuing water in a different country, valuing water in Bangladesh. So I'd like to introduce Saif Qayyum.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Can you hear me? Shall I share my screen for the presentation or it will be shared
by you? No, go ahead.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, just make it a full screen there.
Very good.
Works,
okay. So I'm representing 2030 Water Resources Group. The 2030 Water Resources Group, it's a public-private civil society collaboration that was originally created under the World Economic Forum back in 2008-2009. The purpose of this group is to bring the private sector along with the private sector and jointly to achieve the SDG related goals, the 2030 agenda to address the water security issues. So the 2030 Water Resources Group, it has at the global level, we have the World Bank, IFC, UNDP, the African Development Bank, Inter-American Development Bank, some bilaterals like the Swedish government, the Swiss government, but also from the private sector, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Nestle, and others, and from civil society, the Global Green Growth Initiative, Global Water Partnership, IUCN, and others. It's a public-private civil society collaboration at the global level. And in each country that we work, we also set up a country-level public-private civil society platform. And currently we are operating in 14 countries in Mexico, Peru, Sao Paulo, in Brazil, in South Africa, Kenya, Tanzania, Ethiopia, four programs in India, also in Mongolia, Vietnam, and Bangladesh. So the way we work, we have this like a ACT approach, which is analyze, convene, and transform, which is a simplistic way of putting something that is rather complicated. But what it essentially means that in each country, we start with analytical work and based on the analysis, we convene the various stakeholders, hold inclusive dialogues, and through these dialogues, we bring in transformative actions, which could be projects or programs, or it could be also policy reforms, legal changes, etc. So at the moment, we have around 900 partners working in various areas. Some of the results include about $893 million water sector financing facilitated. We aim for reduction of freshwater abstraction, also reduce non-treated wastewater that is discharged in the environment. And of course, to do that, there are a number of concept notes developed, projects created, publications developed, etc. Our three strategic pillars are transforming value chain, promoting circular economies, and building resilience. I will not go into the details just to give a sense about the group itself before I move on to the Bangladesh valuing water discussion. Some of the pioneering work includes the national level valuing water initiative, the world's largest community drip system in Karnataka in India, first public-private partnerships in wastewater treatment and reuse, both in India and Bangladesh, and others. So some examples of the transformation that was achieved. We worked in Karnataka to leverage irrigation investments, about $650,000 of TA transaction advice, technical assistance provided, which resulted in about $650 million investment catalyzed. In Mongolia, we worked on the water fee pollution law and help to instill the polluter pay principle in the legislation. In Peru, we worked on the first groundwater tariff anywhere that was first applied in Peru. Some of the emerging priorities that are recently coming up include digital development. Disruptive technology is a major area, and we feel that the application of this technology is very important to achieve the SDGs. Market creation, including policy financing and institutional reform for financial innovation, market creation and de-risking of corporate activities, and gender is coming also as an important priority. We are now getting into city-level platforms, work starting with Cape Town, and also country replication currently in 14 countries, expanding into 25, including Pakistan, Rwanda, Madhya Pradesh, and India, and others. And also going for country-level country approach to regional approach, working with the Organization of American States to scale up in Latin America. So at the global level, we have the Governing Council and Steering Board, some of the members in the two bodies mentioned there. And also we have platforms at the country level, as I just mentioned. So this is basically a snapshot of the various country platforms. There are working groups, work streams, thematic committees, advisory committees, technical committees, etc. And these are also committees with public sector, private sector, and civil society. The Bangladesh multi-stakeholder partnership is quite extensive. We have about 11 or 12 projects, programs, which have been either catalyzed, designed, or being implemented at this moment. Some of them are infrastructure investment projects like public-private partnerships in municipal wastewater treatment or industrial wastewater treatment. Some are more policy reform types, governance reforms. One of the initiatives is valuing water. And so we can mean different things when we talk about valuing water. We can have a very broad definition, basically encompass most aspects of water management. But in this particular initiative is very specific. It is about assigning the economic value to the water resources. So how did it start? We had the UN, World Bank, and UN high-level panel for water, which had representatives from 12 head of states and governments. And through the work of the panel, the Bellagio principles were discussed and accepted, very high-level principles. And coming, and now the high-level panel is no longer there, but there is a sort of a follow-up action items agreed. And Bangladesh basically agreed to make progress in the area of valuing water. And it's actually the first time the valuing water exercise is being attempted at the national level. So to do that, we have this high-level partnership, and under this partnership, we have created this Valuing Water Committee, which is chaired by the Principal Coordinator's Office. It's a very elevated position within the government, very respected position. And so that position, and Ms. Suenazi is actually helping to convene the various stakeholders within the government, but also including private sector and civil society groups, with the objective to implement different initiatives, projects for the attainment of streamlining valuing water into the relevant SDG targets. And under this high-level committee, there is also a technical committee at work chaired by a professor of an university. And with this technical committee, basically a project design was made, and then subsequently the design was approved by the government and funded by the government. So through this initiative, first there was a position paper developed which outlined the various principles and considerations for valuing water. And And what we mean by valuing water essentially is that to assign an economic value for a water resource depending on the region, the season, and the various uses. it's a value assigned in pricing terms, in taka terms, from Bangladesh taka terms. But we made it clear that the valuing decisions are very different from the pricing decisions, because pricing tariff reform is very political. So to achieve political buy-in, so we made that clear that through this exercise, we develop what we call this shadow prices table, which shows the value of the water resource depending on various factors, so that that table can become an input into the investment decision making, both by the public sector and by the private sector. But then how much of that value will be priced, whether it will be 100% priced or whether it will be 0% priced, is a different set of policy decisions. So we also, as part of this work, as I mentioned, that this project was created and the government allocated some money for the implementation of this project, which is being implemented by the Water Resources Planning Organization, which is under the Ministry of Water Resources. As part of this work, we also included valuing water considerations in the 8th five-year plan. And Bangladesh has this five-year planning system. It's a very important plan, and for have priority initiatives, strategic initiatives, they all have to be somehow included and referred in the plan, so that later on, during the five-year period, various projects, programs, and policy reforms can be designed, which are aligning with this overarching plan. So there is also this initiative to do a national campaign on valuing water, which we are working both with the government or some private companies like Unilever actively involved in the design of this campaign. And through this campaign, the idea is also to raise awareness that the water is a very critical resource, it's an economic resource, it's not a free good. There is still a tendency in the country to think about water as a free resource. So to raise awareness in the area, to raise awareness about water pollution issues and so on. An ongoing design of an interactive knowledge hub for valuing water, and the knowledge hub can be used sort of to, once this initiative is done, the knowledge hub can continue and share information, raise awareness, etc. The one part of this work also, we have this private sector window as part of the valuing water initiative, and it's crucial that the private sector also understands and considers the impact of the investment decisions that they are making and the impact of their business model. And of course, the private sector can help by improving water use efficiency in their processes, in the damage and compensation assessments, the conservation actions offsetting water stewardship and various other programs that they take, the risk assessment that they can internally do for various policy changes, and also so report all these performances and data to its stakeholders on a transparent basis. The multinational corporations have already started considering value of water. Not all companies are on equal footing here. Some are ahead of the others, but local companies also has to start this process and be more conscious of valuing water. So important to identify and promote options for using valuing water in the private sector decision-making process. So we are still kind of early stage in this initiative. As I mentioned, it's the first time such a initiative is attempted at the national level. Previously, it has been tried in many places at the regional level or at the basin level, but first time we are attempting it to do in the national level. And it's a learning process for us also. So I'll just stop here and happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Terrific, thank you. That was a fascinating presentation where we get to learn about the WRG's multi-stakeholder efforts to evaluate and recognize the value of water as a tool for addressing many of the water-related challenges in countries, as well as the nationwide effort within Bangladesh. Next, we're going to turn to a different part of the world, and we're going to hear from Graham Jewett about valuing the landscape components within water.
Thanks, Anita. So I'm going to do a slightly different presentation today. What I would request the audience is that you put your view on speaker view because I won't be sharing my screen. And in that way, you'll be able to see the detail of what I'd like to present today. So thanks, Anita, IWRA, for the invitation. My name is Graham Jewett. I am Professor of Hydrology and Head of the Department of Water Resources and Ecosystems at IHE Delft Institute for Water Education. But I also have an association with the Center for Water Resources Research at the University of KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa. And much of the thinking and the work that I'll be presenting today came from work that was done in South Africa. So today is World Water Day, and the World Water Development Report, which I think several of us were involved in to some extent, has chosen valuing water as its topic. I think it's an apt topic. It really is an interesting one. And I think what's come out of the report are these sort of key areas of valuing water, which include valuing the water sources, valuing infrastructure, valuing the services, water as an input to various productivity or production exercises, and of course, the social cultural aspects of water. So it brings across those multiple aspects of water quite nicely. I'm going to focus on valuing the sources of water. So picking up on this diagram, which is a part of the publicity for this material this year, you can see from the diagram, a nice representation of the different values of water. And incidentally, in South Africa yesterday, it was Human Rights Day, every March the 21st. And this is, of course, closely linked to water. So providing services to people, sanitation, and water is an important part of a water source and a provision of water. And it's an important human right in many parts of the world. And with it comes the value of water, which changes over time and space, because often there's water is too much, it's too little, it's too dirty. And in all of those cases, water is valued differently. But for many of us, it stops with water coming out of a faucet or a tap. And those of us lucky enough to have water that comes out of a tap have to realize that actually water doesn't come out of a tap. There's a whole value stream upstream, and water is actually produced as a function of services and processes associated with the hydrological cycle that take place in the landscape. And this is really where I want to emphasize these source areas, the areas where water is produced in the landscape. So this is a fairly typical mountain catchment. So it's an area in South Africa known as the Drakensberg. And these are our water towers, if you like. They're the areas which produce and then deliver water services to people. In South Africa, there's quite a strong thinking around how do we get the message of the role of the catchment and the landscape across to consumers of water. And one way of doing that is to equate it to infrastructure, the built infrastructure or gray infrastructure that is typically known to us. So what you can see here is a pipeline, and that pipeline's role is to deliver a good to society. But in the same way that that pipeline produces and delivers services to people, so do these natural areas. So these are known in South Africa as ecological infrastructure, similar to green infrastructure in some ways, some links with the idea of natural capital. But the important part when we consider this more holistically is that there's an integration between the ecological and the built infrastructure. So what happens in the catchments provides water for society through treatment, well, first through bulk infrastructure, then through treatment, through into the gray infrastructure. And having provided that water, the catchment and the natural resources are actually the recipients of the waste. So they have a number of very important roles that are absolutely critical in the provision of water to society. But thanks to the World Water Development Report of 2018, we know that actually only about 5% of the water, of the expenditure on water resources management takes place in the catchment. And the bulk is actually sitting in that gray infrastructure. And that is highly problematic because what we're starting to see is a degradation of those landscapes and an associated degradation in the services which they provide. So in this picture here, we see deforestation of the Miombo woodlands in Tanzania. But in South Africa, in the Umgeni catchment, where I spent a lot of time doing a lot of work, we see invasive alien vegetation taking over. So the green area in the photograph that you can see is actually a woody acacia vegetation, comes from Australia, which has invaded the riparian zones. And you can see that it's green when the rest of the landscape is brown. So what happens in the dry times is it uses a huge amount of water relative to a landscape which looks like this. So in terms of getting this message across, one of the ways that we can value water is actually through monetary value or cost. And we've chosen to do that in the Umgeni catchment because it is really a language that the policymakers and the planners and the catchments are talking and which they understand. And if we don't make that step into monetary valuation of the catchment services, then typically they are just ignored. So based on the very well-known Working for Water program, which is a government program in South Africa, where jobs are created through to people who are removing these invasive alien vegetation from the catchment and has been running for many years, we have a very good idea of what the cost of removing these invasive alien plants or restoring the catchments in other ways, such as mitigating overgrazing. It's also interesting that we've just entered the UN decade on restoration. So that's something else to bear in mind. The other thing we know through a lot of our hydrological work in the catchments in these areas, through understanding the processes, is just how much water is used in these landscapes and how much water we lose out by if the catchments become degraded. So through a number of, through transmitting that hydrological understanding into hydrological models, we are able to know how much water we can release from the catchment or save or reclaim from the catchment when we restore them. We are also able to cost that. In South Africa, we use an approach called the unit reference value. And basically what this does is we can cost a cubic meter of water from an investment. And that investment includes restoration of the catchment. The interesting thing about the unit reference value is that both the numerator and denominator are subject to a discount rate, which makes it a bit different from some of the more simple assessments of restoration that are often made. And it is an approach which is used in the development of built infrastructure in South Africa. So what we wanted to do with our ecological infrastructure restoration was to ensure that this was compatible with what we see in the built infrastructure. So what did the results tell us? Well, I've converted this into US dollar of water. So basically, how much water could we get from a $1 invested? And what we can see in different parts, the Bavians and the Umgeni are two different catchments, but the cost of generating water for society in these areas through restoration is equivalent and often cheaper than water from other sources. And that includes desalination, which typically we see about $1 per cubic meter when reuse. reservoir construction and interbasin transfers are probably our most expensive, but also most preferred option at the moment. Simple interbasin transfers, which are gravity fed, are quite cost effective. And in the South African context, boreholes are quite effective too. And of course, this is it ranges, of course, in different areas. But one of the other things that we did is we thought, no, why do we have to base the value of these areas which we are restoring just on the restoration cost? Because these areas are actually should be protected and maintained. But of course, maintenance and protection isn't free. It doesn't cost nothing. There are costs associated with making sure that grasslands are burnt regularly or invasive plants are removed, or other management costs associated with it. But what is clear, very, very clear, is that maintenance is much cheaper than restoration. And that if we were to invest in maintaining these water source areas and protecting them, we would sustain a very good water supply from them. So to wrap up or conclude, my take home messages, if you like, is just using the monetary values, investments in landscape that produce water are sound, just on the monetary values. And then there are these multiple other values which also enhance this investment. So that takes the value of that investment well beyond just the return on investment for restoration or even maintenance. And maintenance really is cheaper than restoration. And that's something that we forget. Our natural landscapes need maintenance as well. And quite frankly, we often neglect the maintenance on our built infrastructure. And that has big costs downstream. But just as much as the maintenance on built infrastructure is important, we need to maintain our ecological infrastructure too. So that's the end of my presentation. And I think I'm looking forward to the questions.
Terrific. Thank you for a very insightful presentation, highlighting to all of us the importance and the value of ecological infrastructure, and also the fact that maintenance is definitely going to be a much more valuable way to go than restoration. For that, I'm going to turn the microphone over to the IWRA Executive Office, where he will lead the Q&A session.
Hi, everyone. Well, thank you for those great presentations. We really appreciated that. I think that gave us a lot of different perspectives, a lot of different case studies, a lot of different geographical zones to kind of compare. So we have a lot of good questions already coming from the audience, but I'll remind people to go ahead and pose their questions, either questions that you have specifically for one speaker or questions that you might have that sort of a bridge between the topics suggested by two or more of the speakers, or topics that maybe relate to your own work, and to kind of see how the speakers might pick up from there. So go ahead and post those in the box down at the center of your Zoom control panel there, and we'll go from there. So The first question here is from an anonymous viewer. Let's go ahead and the first one we see here, Mrs. Anonymous, says, "By valuing groundwater, how would we mitigate the effect of oil spills and industrial safety?" And I think you could probably look at this as being any kind of pollution that disturbs groundwater in underdeveloped areas that have not yet had a lot of oil exploration, I understand. I guess the question to me is you know, how do we use the different understandings about the values of groundwater to either mitigate or to weigh against the risk of pollution in areas where pollution hasn't maybe already existed? So. Does anyone want to respond to from the panel? Feel free just to unmute yourself, and you don't need to be recognized by me.
guess I would chime in by saying the valuing groundwater doesn't necessarily have to require economic analysis and incorporation of the economic analysis into our value system. So if we value the protection of our groundwater from oil spillage and industrialization, then we're going to put in place strong regulations and protective regimes and ways in which we're going to, prior to approving or allowing any projects to come into place, that are going to evaluate what is the risk of engaging in some sort of activity such as oil drilling or industrialization. And within that, there needs to be some sort of process through which there's an evaluation of how will those activities lead to, or where are the potential entries of contamination from those activities into the aquifer, and coming up with ways of then putting in place what is often called a multiple barriers approach, which will seek to ensure that there are multiple barriers or many stopgap points along the way that will help to ensure that any potential risks will not actually come into fruition. So I think that recognizing the value of groundwater includes not just incorporating it into any cost-benefit analysis, but also thinking about what are the ways in which we go about protecting, analyzing, monitoring the activities that might have an impact on it.
Great response.
Just to add to that, one way to look at it also, that these are also investment risks for the private companies. So one aspect is the government, that is Anita just mentioned, understanding of that. But from a private company's point of view, the oil spillage is a risk. And by oil spillage, if they also sort of impact the water body, that is also an additional risk, and they will have repercussions for that. So what the company can do at the policy level and also at the ground level to address those risks. So maybe it's about having the right people on the ground. Maybe it's about having the right due diligence that is done.
Good responses. Let's move on to this next question here from David Groenfeld, who asks, what is the reason for limiting the concept of value, his quotes on mine, to economic value? If we have learned one thing from this past year, is the importance of water justice and social equality. And combined with environmental honesty of investing in sustainable rivers, it seems that limiting to economic value alone would be insufficient. Can you comment? I think several of our panelists have kind of compared economic values with other values. So feel free to kind of, for anyone to kind of weigh in on that.
Yeah, so maybe I will start. So that's a very good question, by the way. And we spent about a year on this topic. And the first position paper we did had beautiful methodologies with all kinds of values that should be considered social, cultural, even spiritual. We have a river in Bangladesh named Turat, where every year about 20 million people assemble to pray. It's the second largest gathering of Muslims after the Hajj. So then how do you also factor that activity in the valuation of the water that flows through the Turat? So very, very interesting discussions. But at the end, so what we agreed that for the purposes of the shadow prices table, that's the table that the government will use in all public investment decision-making to in which they sort of do the cost benefit of various factors. Currently, water is not one of those factors. So by doing the shadow prices table, at least water will be a factor, and water cost and opportunity cost risk is sort of more systematically incorporated in project decision-making. But the agreement right now is only economic value is assigned in the shadow prices table. And the shadow prices table is sort of a snapshot at a particular time. So it has to also change, and the variables will change, and the prices have to be also updated, which is something the government needs to do. And that's an area where the capacity of the government also have to be increased, improved, so that they are able to update the shadow prices table. We hope that over time, that the shadow prices table will be also incorporate other values beyond economic values. That's on one side. And the other side is that for some decisions, like maybe this valuing exercise is not the silver bullets for all problems, right? Because it could be also allocative decisions. So maybe at the basin level authority or regional authority can decide for environmental flow, this much water we have to remain, which we have to keep in the river for fish and for transportation and for other purposes. So that cannot be extracted. Or they can also decide for this marginal farmer group, they need to have this much, this amount of water to survive. So those allocative decisions can also play a role. And very recently also the High Court has basically given a judgment that the rivers have the same rights as human beings. So it's also something to think about in the overall legislative system, the different factors and how valuation can be sort of moved ahead in the particular situation of the country.
Yeah, I also add something. I think the pricing itself may play as a limiting factor, but also it could be also played as a leveraging instrument to better understand the value of the water. As we have discussed already, understanding value of water is very complex and very difficult to express it in a simple way, but the pricing itself can be used as an instrument as well.
Yeah, and I think that's the approach that I've found quite useful. Certainly in the work that I've done, it took me a long time to reconcile myself with getting to an economic valuation. And I was quite hesitant to even enter or follow that path. But having done so, I think it has been useful, particularly as an illustrative tool, as a leverage point, and really to see that even if we just think of that as one part of the value of water, that there's a that it can stand alone in an economic sense if necessary. And of course, I only touched on water quantity aspects, the immense water quality benefits, which can be quantified economically as well. So I think it, you know, I would see economic value as one of a package of tools providing, supporting the multiple values of water.
Well, I'll take a slightly different stance in which I see that there's immense value to putting a monetary value on groundwater. I think that there are immense challenges within that, particularly as it relates to how are we calculating some benefits when to certain people the value of $1 is different than the value of a dollar to another people. And I think at the same time, as all of my co-panelists have said, that it provides us with useful information and it can help raise attention of some of the values of water such that it does come into play in decision-making forums where otherwise it may not have. And yet at the same time, I think there's a need to look at things through the lens of multi-criteria analysis, where the multi-criteria analysis is not just based on one unit, because we have incommensurate values here, but it's looking at some of the trade-offs where we're not only valuing and looking at the impacts in terms of the dollar value, but also perhaps on the equity values or the distributive effects or the other aspects of our processes, such that my recommendation would be that in decision-making processes, we have some sort of dollar value, which helps us to have a form of communication and take into consideration the impacts and the values of water. But we also consider some of the parts of water and the value of water that may be harder to put into that same decision criteria.
Well, that was great. Does anyone have a follow-on on that? Don't limit yourself to just want one response. You guys can have a conversation amongst each other. That's what we're here for. Have a conversation. Now, one thing, if no one's going to respond, I'll have to take our attendees to task here, folks. This morning we met, had another very good webinar at 9 in the morning. And I'll be honest, we had not had quite as much coffee as we probably should have, and we were quite tired. But the questions were more numerous this morning. So please avail yourself of this opportunity to pose some questions to our panelists. Your morning colleagues were much more curious. And so please pose the questions, put them in the Q&A box, and we would love to have some more interaction. So Anita, did you?
I have a question for Saif, which is, what motivated Bangladesh to decide to, because it's very unique for a country to implement this kind of valuation process at the national level. And I'm just curious to hear a little bit about the history and what motivated this project.
Yeah, so Anita, that's a good question also. The high level panel was there when the Bangladesh Prime Minister was a member of the panel. That participation helped. And the panel membership is at like a very, very top level, but under the panel, there was the group of Sherpas. So for Bangladesh, the Sherpa was the principal coordinator in SDG Affairs, a very, very high level position. So we had this multi-stakeholder platform already set up, and we had the principal coordinator working with us. So we had a lot of conversation with the principal coordinator to see how this can be taken forward, because we knew the high-level panel is there, and then one day it will no longer be there. And so there will be a lot of decisions made, but then how those decisions can be addressed at the country level. And we worked very closely with the Prime Minister's office and Minister of Water Resources, and also some private companies like Coke was particularly vocal in the area. And we worked very closely with Coke and also with IUCN to draw the different interests, technical expertise that was available. And we felt that this is something that is worth an attempt, and the political will certainly is there. And so it's a matter of sort of connecting all the dots that are necessary to get a concrete project or concrete actions going. But as I said, also this was also like an innovation for us to work in this area, to try this exercise. And as we had the various discussions, so we sort of created concrete milestones, like what can be done now. We can talk a lot and then go nowhere, but what can we do now, and and use that as a baseline to move to the next. So it's because of that, basically, we created this, worked with the government and created this pilot project. And through this pilot project, this shadow prices table is getting developed. And also this pilot project has a private sector window to work with interested private companies and at least learn from their best practices, good practices that they have within their companies, whether in Bangladesh or in their global area of operation, and show that those practices to other companies to encourage them. And potentially to also have regulatory interventions designed from that learning. It's a lot of actions that actually is coming through that initiative, this national campaign that I just spoke about. And this is something we are designing now with the partners, and also some of the other activities as well.
All right. Did anyone else have a follow-up there? All right. You know, one of the things that we talked about a lot this morning was the need for good methodological frameworks and good data to inform those frameworks. Obviously, without a good framework to the data, these things, you know, this is how you kind of gather the information to make these choices, these ideas, whether or not it was economic, whether or not it was cultural resource values, whether or not it was other types of values. Would the panel like to kind of comment on maybe frameworks or data points that they find very useful, or that they kind of guide their work, or work that maybe they've been finding interesting? Don't all speak at once.
Well, I guess in our case, in the work that we did, what we found was that a history of research or a history of monitoring, particularly from a hydrological point of view, to be quite direct, I suppose, was that we've got a long history of research catchments in South Africa, which was invaluable to some of the work that we could do. But equally, the Working for Water program and the efforts in understanding costs associated with that and the record keeping and the monitoring was very important in keeping the understanding the costs associated with what we're trying to do. Putting those together into a sort of standard framework was quite difficult, particularly when it came to the cost benefit analysis that we did. Now, the approach that we used, which is what was called the unit reference value, is something which is used more in South Africa than internationally, and perhaps not even accepted internationally, because some of the economists would have to explain a little bit more why the process that they've used around using discount rates, and which discount rates and which side of the equation the discount rates should apply to. But I think what we have seen as a matter of course is that the instruments that we've used to compare investments in the ecological infrastructure with built infrastructure have been far too limiting, particularly in terms of the view of how long an investment will bring benefits to. I think the governor of the Bank of England in the past called this the tragedy of the horizon, where you start to think that investment should bring a real return in 30 or 40 years, whereas the investments that we see in ecological infrastructure should bring benefits well, well beyond that. And I think this is one of the complexities we have, particularly with the economic instruments and the different ways in which not only water are valued, and the natural resources as a whole struggle in those frameworks. So Yif is sort of nodding. So I hope I made sense from a sort of economic point of view, because it's certainly not my field.
Saif or Normandy, would you like to comment? Or Anita?
Well, for me, the water security index from the Asia Development Bank was really useful for understanding the whole situation of Ulaanbaatar. And I think it's very important to have this kind of proxy indication on the whole assessment, on the whole condition of water supply and sanitation. And in the urban context, I think very important to also include and take into consideration about the socioeconomic implications. And those include the traditions and also spirituality of the community that use water for their own practices. And it's really hard and really complicated to value those and make it and turn it into a proxy indication. And I'm very excited or also happy to discuss about it further with fellow colleagues as well.
Yeah, I just want to add one thing. You know, we have to be mindful of local politics. We can assign, we can do very rigorous exercise and sort of assign these values and consider cultural and others social values. But just to give you one example, we work with one city corporation helping to create the municipal wastewater infrastructure, the sewer network, the treatment plant, the fecal sludge management plant, the first public-private partnership in the sector in the country. And we have about 54 ward commissioners who have different wards within that municipality. And when it comes to getting their buy-in, they all say, you know, yes, we need this project, but you cannot take away money from my budget. So because all these 54 get certain allocation from the ministry and they don't want to give up anything from their budget, yet they want this infrastructure project to be implemented. And this is a lot of negotiation happens there, so to basically make that happen. I just wanted to flag that we can do a very sound technical exercise, but then we have to be very mindful about the political economy.
Any of the other panelists want to just weigh in there? Well, then, you know, we have a couple of questions posed by another anonymous viewer. And they both kind of revolve around questions around using values of water, particularly groundwater, relating them to the commons, and looking at damages to the commons or ways to be better stewards of the commons. Would any of our panelists comment on how maybe application of their research, their work to commons, the commons and commons theory?
I will comment very briefly, and then I'm sorry, I apologize to everyone that I have another meeting that I have to attend. But I think the groundwater is often related to the commons in terms of the fact that it is considered number one rival, and that one person's groundwater use can influence another availability of groundwater to the entires, and also that it's not excludable and that anybody can pump from anywhere that they can. So where this comes into play in the research that I'm doing is looking at the ways in which institutions and norms in society come together to collectively manage their resources. So a number of instances where this comes into play is thinking about, do we create community-based groundwater management, or does there need to be some sort of oversight from the state to help to enforce community-based management? And so looking at the ways in which we create structures, who is involved in those structures and the dynamics across those structures as we think about how to manage the resource. In some ways, this comes up also equally, not with groundwater, but with Saif was saying, in that there are differing managers that have access to different pools of water, and they have to reach some sort of collective decision about who is going to give some of their money into this project. And so what we're really looking at in all of these, be it commons or other situations, is the fact that humans are the ones making decisions, and that there's the dynamics between humans, the structures we put into place, and the relationships they have to make decisions about what's going to be the outcome. And I think this is particularly true for groundwater because we have less well-developed resources for groundwater, and because it's unseen, and so it's harder to monitor and enforce the groundwater management. I'm not sure if that answered the question at all, but hopefully it gives some sort of insight into the role of the commons and groundwater. And with that, I do apologize that you need to leave.
Well, thank you for your comments and for your participation and for your great moderation as well. She's gone. All right, well, thank you, Dr. Moman. Yeah, thanks. All right, did anyone else want to comment on the commons, comment on the commons?
Yeah, maybe just this, that it might be helpful for the countries to work on that in the sense of in their legislation, they can define the role more clearly. So for example, in the case of Bangladesh, we have the Bangladesh Water Act, and the Water Act has given sort of the priority, like which sector has priority when it comes to water use, like drinking water is right on top. So the whole idea being that it's a human right and you cannot sort of take that away. So it's helpful to use the legislative mechanisms to define that, and that will help, that should help down the line for various decisions.
Okay, good comment. Now, I'm just going to circle back around here. Is a comment from David Groenfeld on his earlier question, but what he says is what motivated his question was his opinion, his view that water decisions should be recognized as moral decisions that should be approached through a sense of water ethics. And he points out this is how a society handles medical life and death issues and water's life and death. Could anyone maybe want to talk about how, you know, the different ways that we talk about valuing water can feed into a question or an idea about using water ethics, or an ethical, moral framework to make decisions around water resources?
I think there's been a lot of work over the past few years in really bringing a sort of environmental and social justice into the decision making. And, you know, it started with integrated water resources management to an extent, and really recognizing human rights and environmental rights. So I think if you compare the situation to perhaps 20 years ago, where in many parts of the world, especially with environmental flow has been quite a strong part of water resources thinking, there's been an advance. I think more and more, that's also a field of practice and publication, and the role now of citizen science even enhances it. So I think there's a steady progression in that. I also saw your comment about medical and ethics and things like that. You know, and I agree as a sentiment, But you know, if you look at the COVID vaccine rollouts, the reality is the rich countries have got the vaccines and the poor countries don't. So whatever you think about the ethics of poor or vulnerable people in poor countries not having access to vaccines, while not vulnerable people in rich countries do, there's a moral and ethical problem associated with that, and it's driven by finances.
Thank you for that comment. That was really good. That was a good observation with COVID as well. Would anyone else like to comment there?
I mean, just this. I think in democracies, it's very difficult to ignore the moral dimension on water resource management. Like if someone is attempting it, it's almost political suicide. So I think also to think about if you're thinking about long-term meaningful progress in some of the more difficult areas, one idea is to work closely with politicians and try to get into, they all have their election manifestos and try to give inputs or influence the election manifestos. Like even if they have something very broad, something they want to do, say on groundwater management for a particular area or for the whole country could be. And then to influence those and have those mentioned in the political manifestos, election manifestos. So once they get elected, those politicians can be held accountable to make decisions or make progress in those areas.
The wide variety of the use and the form of the water just shows how it is into our everyday life. And I think the whole, our understanding of the use of the water shapes our attitude towards water, which is expressed in our policy development also, and also water management allocation and setting the pricing as well. So I think the current democracy and also the whole regulation does restrict the water usage in terms of ethics and traditions, but at the same time, I think it's very important to have it as well.
Okay, excellent. Very good comment. I think we have time for maybe one final question. I'm not entirely sure I understand it, but it might be interesting. We'll see. So Fintosha Mohammed asks, do you think the trend of water rights and regulations are getting too strict and restrictive, and valuing water bodies in moral and ethical terms may become burdensome on people? What do people think of this? I mean, this is a different question. We haven't had this before, so I pose it to the, what do people think? Does this constant evaluation, moral terms, ethical terms, monetary terms, does this become burdensome? Is there a sort of extra work that's being kind of required of people to sort of just to show the value of what the water bodies are wanting to protect? Does this become kind of a problematic?
I'm not sure I fully understand the question, but you know, I think that the reality is, if we consider the multiple facets of water, and its different dimensions and decision making, it is necessarily more complex, and that does create a burden administratively in some cases. But I don't think it's something we should be shying away from, because the simplistic planning we've seen compromises the water resource in the long term. So the reality is understanding and managing things in an integrated water integrated way is quite complex.
I I mean, what I can add to that, in the developing countries that we work, we often see that the governments are very good at formulating policies, adopting laws, but not very good at implementing. So if things are too restrictive, it will get also very difficult to implement, and then it won't be implemented. So have to be seen in that perspective, that what is the benefit we are getting, the country is getting, by having something that may not be implemented. So maybe in such cases, it has to be phased. Maybe it's a gradual process, or needs a good action plan, or needs good widespread community buy-in, or all of them. So this has to be thought about from more from an implementer's lens, and not just to have good policies, laws, and frameworks, but also make sure these are actually implementable.
All right. No wonder, did you have anything to comment there? Okay. Well, it's about 4:30 here. So I think that we've had about our 90 minutes. It went quick, I think, for me, and probably quick for you as well. So I would again like to really thank my panel. A big thanks to everyone. Normandry Erdine, a PhD candidate at the Asia-Pacific Regional and the Asia-Pacific Regional Ambassador for Water Science Policy. Saif Qayyum, the Bangladesh Country Coordinator for 2030 Water Resources Group. Graham Jewett, Honorary Professor at the Center of Water Resources Research at the University of KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa. And Anita Millman, Associate Professor, Department of Environmental Conservation, University of Massachusetts Amherst, and a great moderator. So I know that some of the panel and IWRA ourselves were all on Twitter. So please go ahead and give us a look up and give us a follow if you're interested. And if any of these presentations left you interested in learning more, you can check out our LinkedIn webpage and continue the discussion there, and follow us for more IWRA updates. I really hope that everyone in the audience found the insights provided by our panel for this special event really useful. We really value that you were able to take the time to spend a little of World Water Day 2021 with us, and we appreciate the time you gave us. So it gave me a lot of material to think about and work on, and I hope it's going to kind of drive you forward for the rest of the year in the ways that you're thinking, the ways that you're researching and working. So thank you. To remind you all again, this webinar was brought to you by the International Water Resources Association. We are a 50-year-old nonprofit, non-governmental educational organization. We focus on bridging disciplines and geographies and connecting professionals, students, individuals, corporations, and institutions who are concerned with the sustainable use of the world's water resources. So if you're interested in knowing more about the association or becoming a member, please go to www.iwra.org. And just to remind everybody, we'll have a recording of the webinar, and the presentations will all be on that same website, www.iwra.org. So go ahead and you can rewatch this webinar, or you can tune in and watch this morning's webinar. We'll have those up in a few days. So on behalf of the whole IWRA office, we wish you a very, very happy World Water Day 2021, and thank you for tuning into the webinar. So thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you.